I would like to thank the organizing committee for inviting me to participate in Macula 2022. I apologize for not being able to be live due to COVID. I will review anti-diabetic drugs and their effect on the retina. There are many anti-diabetic drugs from the medieval times were using French lilac that contains guanidine to treat diabetes. In the 1920s, two of these molecules fused together gave us metformin. Also in the 1920s, four men were able to isolate from the pancreatic insula the hormone insulin. Insulin is a hormone that folds to itself and then cleaved to give us peptide B and A, which is insulin, and peptide C, which is amylin. Please remember that for the future. In the 1940s, work on sulfonamide antibiotics by accident gave us sulfonylureas, which are insulin secretagogues, but they are also good herbicides. So with these three drugs, we managed diabetes and were able to have a good effect on diabetic retinopathy, decreasing microvascular complications. Since the 90s, there has been a flurry of activity to produce new drugs for diabetes, especially of the class of PPAR gamma, of PPAR agonists. The alpha agonists are the fibrate, decreasing lipids. The gamma agonists are glitazones, decreasing sugars. However, this field is difficult with many failures, toxicities, and withdrawals. Troglitazone, the first drug approved due to Park Davis lobbying for the removal of the FDA officer who objected, then retracted the medication 2 years later due to liver toxicity. The current medications have a black label warning for fluid retention, CHF, and adipogenic weight gain. Many other drugs were withdrawn from phase 2 or phase 3 trials, as we can see here. We also developed drugs to inhibit glucosidase enzyme in the gut, like acarbose, which will decrease postprandial glucose, as well as they decrease by 25% new diabetes diagnosis in pre-diabetics. The peptide C, or amylin, from the insulin prohormone also reduces stomach emptying, appetite, and glucagon. However, the human sequence is amyloidogenic, so the drug based on that is modified and uses a part of the rat sequence to reduce amyloidogenicity. Another class of drugs are incretins. They're coming from the intestinal cell called enteroendocrine cell. GLP-1 decreases glucagon, increases insulin, decreases food intake, and decreases gastric motility. It is broken down by DPP-4, and thus are two drugs. The agonists are usually injectable, and the inhibitors of DPP-4 are by pills. We also looked at the kidney, how it manages sugars, and about 180 grams of glucose are excreted and then reabsorbed by the kidney per day. This reabsorption, 90%, happens by SGLT2. The SGLT2 inhibitors increase urinary glucose excretion by about 80 to 90 grams per day. They decrease blood volume and blood pressure, and they reduce cardiovascular risk, but they also increase UTIs. So in the last 2 decades, we have 6 new classes of drug for a total of 9 classes. So what is the effect of the newer drugs on diabetic retinopathy? The ACCORD study studied the classics plus the PPAR agonists and the glucosidase inhibitors, but they were not designed to answer the specific drug classes. So is there literature that can help us answer this? There's, as we know, different evidence available with their own pluses and minuses. If we look at PPAR agonists, we'll see that there was a very strong case report with challenge to show increased DME, and then a retrospective analysis of more than 100,000 patients to also show the same thing. However, post hoc analysis of the ACCORD trial did not see any effect on DME. Thus, in summary, the PPAR gamma agonists, they don't have a consistent effect on diabetic retinopathy, but please be on the lookout for potential DME risk. If we look at the glucosidase inhibitors, not enough data. However, they don't appear to have any significant change in retinopathy. Same thing for amylin. If we look now at incretins with a GLP-1 receptor agonist, the first one of them that was approved, we have several studies. There is two big, large randomized control trials, the SUSTAIN and the LEADER trial. The SUSTAIN saw an increase in diabetic retinopathy risk. The LEADER saw no difference. Both saw decreased nephropathy. Post hoc analysis of the SUSTAIN suggested that the increased diabetic retinopathy was maybe from too rapid decline on A1C in the first 16 weeks. Additional randomized control trials saw neither increase nor decrease. And additional non-randomized control trials also showed similar findings. So we think that the GLP-1 receptor agonists, they have really no much effect except semaglutide, which may be problematic. In DPP-4-eyes, we have a single randomized controlled trial, which showed slightly higher diabetic retinopathy events, 2.8 versus 2.2, but they didn't do much of a statistical analysis. Subsequent retrospective studies showed also increased in diabetic retinopathy, two of them, but two other ones did not see that and showed opposite result. Meta-analysis gave us mixed results as expected. Now, if we go to the last new class of medications, we have a single randomized controlled trial, which shows no difference in diabetic retinopathy, although nephropathy does go down. Subsequent post-hoc analysis showed again no statistical significant differences. Other studies retrospective showed a decrease in the incidence, but no difference in the progression. And the same thing was seen in simulation studies and meta-analysis studies. A more recent study raised the possibility of retinal vein occlusion associated with these drugs, in particular in patients with older age and advanced kidney disease. Take-home messages is that glitazones may be neutral or increase DME. Acarbose may decrease new diabetes mellitus, but neutral on diabetic retinopathy. Amylin, neutral on diabetic retinopathy. GLP-1 receptor agonists, most of them are neutral, but semaglutide may worsen. DPP-4-I, there's exertion, but no proof that there's a slight increase in the risk. And SGLT2s, there is a suggestion of decreased incidence, equal progression, and maybe an increase in the retinal vein occlusion. I would like to thank my fellow Dimitrios Detakis for helping making this presentation, and you for listening. Again, apologies for not being able to be in person. Thank you very much.